keep you along today. Got a lot to do, a lot to say. Got a great lesson. Good to be in church. Good to be in God's house. I'm glad God is still for us. Yeah, well, we came here, so I'm excited. I got a good lesson for you. I think you're going to enjoy that. So, Brother Brian, you come, start us in a song, and we'll be ready to roll.
Thank you.
You are welcome.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our morning service here at church. Great to see everybody this morning. And welcome to those who are watching as well. We love you. And if you can come, come. And if not, make sure you watch us online. That's important, too. You get to hear the word one way or the other. Welcome. Would everyone please turn in your hymn books today to page number 327, please. Page number 327 in your hymn books. Page number 327, we're going to start with Higher Ground. Would everyone here please stand? And we're going to continue. We're just doing first and last verses on all these congregational songs. We want pastor's message to ring loud and clear.
Amen.
And give him as much time as he needs to give us God's word, because there's nothing like God's word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, 327, first and last. Let's all sing Higher Ground. Here we go. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Last verse. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Man, thank you, everybody. I'll just turn one page forward. Page 328. Page number 328. And let's all continue. Good morning. Welcome. We'll wait for a second here. Good morning. Welcome. Page number 328 in your hymn books. All right. Page number 328. All right. 328. Let's all continue. First and last verses. I want that mountain. Here we go.
I saw the jot of prayerlessness upon the mountain high. He laughed so hard at my unbended knee. No longer in the wilderness I'll stay, and so I cry. I want that mountain, it belongs to me. I want that mountain. I want that mountain where the milk and honey flow, where the grapes of Eshkol grow. I want that mountain. I want that mountain. The mountain that my Lord has given me. Last verse. Let every giant of distress and unbelief and sin get ready now to vacate, for you see, I've come from out the wilderness. I know I'm going to win. I want that mountain. It belongs to me. I want that mountain. I want that mountain where the milk and honey flow, where the grapes of Eshkol grow. I want that mountain. I want that mountain. The mountain that my Lord has given me.
Amen. Good singing. Story of Caleb. I believe he was 80 years old, a little over 80 years old. Said, I want that mountain. Give me something to do. You know, you and I, we want the big easy button. I got a big easy button from Staples. Anybody ever see the big easy button from Staples? That was easy. All right, enough of that. Time for somebody to be a Christian. Said, give it to me, Lord. It may be hard, but give it to me. Give me the mountain. I didn't see, there's no verse that says, give me the lazy boy.
Not yet.
Take up thy lazy boy and follow me. Doesn't say that. Take up thy cross. Amen. I want that mountain. Give me something tough. We can handle this. He did tough stuff for us. Stand up for I'm happy this morning. You got to be here. Amen. Man, my grandkids. Minus 11. That's Amen. What it was. Was that a closeout?
Yes, sir.
Minus 11 at my house. Grandkids, the apple don't fall far from the tree, though you know that. Grandkids, Caesar, grandkids. No socks, no shoes, no shirt, running around the yard. I'm thinking, do I want to join them? And the Holy Spirit says, no, you dummy. They're children. Their brains don't work yet. Remember Todd Kavanaugh? You remember Brother Todd? He had a place up in Loon Mountain. Remember Brother Todd? We'd go up there, spend one day with them, just have fun. It was one of those timeshares. You got all the amenities, skates, skiing, ice skating, hockey, recreation, all kinds of stuff. They had this hot tub. This is good. It's good for you to stand for a few minutes. I got to tell you a story. It had this hot tub outside.
All right.
Brother Hal, we could get in it, maybe 15 of us in that hot tub. Boiling water, not boiling water, but hot tub. It's snowing out. Probably 3 degrees. And we're in a hot tub. Every once in a while, somebody would get the big idea, and we'd dare each other. How many think people do stupid things? We dare each other. We're in the field in a hot tub, 3 degrees. How about you do a snow angel, I'll do a snow angel.
Oh, my goodness.
God is my witness. I jumped out of that hot tub, out in the middle of that field, the biggest snow angel you ever saw. Jumped back in that tub, burned, it hurt. And I said to myself, why? And then I said, I'll never do that again. But every year, you dare me? I do it. Amen. Anyhow, we had fun. I don't know how I got talking about that. I'm glad it's warm in here. I'll be glad when the weather changes, and so we thank God for that. Good to be in church this morning. I got a great lesson for you. I want you to listen very, very carefully. I'm excited this morning. It's good to be excited.
Amen.
And I got a great lesson. I worked so very hard on this. I hope this will come across. Let's bow. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, be with us this morning. A lot of needs that are here, a lot of concerns. And we need you, God. People need the Lord. And that's all. That's all. We have come into this house and gathered in your name to worship you. Teach us thy word. Tell us the stories. Work on us. Help us. Develop us. And change us. Father, please help the preacher this morning. Help me to bring this across to pursue this avenue in the way you and the Holy Spirit intend for this sermon to go. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Take your Bible, book of Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26. I need to make a correction, so if you don't mind, we'll start with our bulletin. I do need to make a correction on the bulletin. I put a verse on there, and I'd like to blame Lynn for the mistake, but I went back and checked my handwriting, and it was not Miss Lynn. She's perfect. I'm the one that's a mess. But I want you to look this verse up for me. It's on your bulletin there, Isaiah 36. You see where I have on the bulletin? That says nothing to do with nothing. Brother Al, did you read that?
Yes, sir, I did.
Did it make any sense to you?
Well, I decided that something must have to do with go and rent your clothes.
Yes.
Go to a house and rent them. Don't buy them.
We're not renting no clothes this morning. It's the wrong verse, Brother Al.
Amen.
So you can't get there from here. So if you want, I'll go ahead and fix that real fast for you. If you don't mind, I want you to look it up because I picked those verses to put them in here. I just put the wrong numbers. Isaiah chapter 36, if you will, let me just fix the bulletin real fast. And I won't come back to it. I'm only going to read them and then I'll be gone. It goes with the sermon. I wanted you to see it. Isaiah 36. And the verse that I want you to read, what else do I have on here? 30. Which one do I have on here? 22. Isaiah 36 and verse 22. Then came Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, that was over the household, and Sheba the scribe, and Joah the son of Asaph the recorder, and Hezekiah with their clothes rent. That has nothing to do with nothing here. So if you'll go back to verse number 16. Yep. I'm sorry, verse 18. 36:18. Beware lest Hezekiah persuade you. All I want you to see is one word. Beware lest Hezekiah persuade you. Now, Hezekiah, in this case, is trying to do the will of God. He's a good man. Trying to get him to do what they're supposed to do. Here, in this case, we have the opposite side trying to stop what the man of God is trying to do. Beware lest Hezekiah persuade you, saying, the Lord will deliver us. Have any of the gods of the nation delivered his hand out of the hand of the king of Assyria? So they were saying, no, your God can't help you. So Hezekiah is trying to persuade them, stay with God. Stay with God. And they're trying to warn him, don't let him persuade you. By the way, it's good for you to go to church and let the preacher persuade you. Persuade you to do what God wants you to do. There you go. Got the whole sermon. Can we have an invitation and go home? You're dreaming. Okay, Acts 26. I got to read you a little story. Acts chapter number 26. I had to fix the bulletin there. Acts 26, verse number 19, if you will. Acts chapter 26, verse number 19. And I want you to go ahead and read it with me. We're going to read down to verse 28, okay? Acts chapter 26, verse number 19. The Apostle Paul under trial here. And King Agrippa is here, and he's trying to talk to King Agrippa. What was going on? Why they're accusing him? All this taking place. And so Paul tells the story of his testimony, how he got saved. He's trying to witness to him. Acts chapter 26, verse number 19. Now, he's trying to get the king saved. Do kings need to get saved? Do politicians need to get saved? Does law enforcement need to get saved? Do judges need to get saved? Do daddies need to get saved? Everybody needs to get saved. So Paul said, I'm not going to pull any stones back. Verse number, chapter 26, verse 19. Read with me, if you will, verse 19 to 28. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God, and do the works meet for repentance. For these causes, the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, witnessing to both small and great, saying none other things than those things which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. And as he thus spake for himself, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, thou art beside thyself. Much learning doth make thee mad. But he said, I'm not mad, most noble Festus, but speak forth the words of truth and soberness. For the king knoweth of these things, before whom also I speak freely, for I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him, for this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Almost persuaded. I want to preach a sermon to you this morning called Persuaded to Do the Right Thing. Persuaded to do the right thing. Brother Brian, you come, there's another song, and then I'm going to take right off.
From what Pastor just mentioned, would everyone here please turn in your hymn books to page number 275, please.
275. Yes. Amen.
Page number 275. Amen. You may remain seated for this. Yes. We're going to sing all three verses of this. Perhaps written specifically, don't know, but perhaps written specifically for what you just read,
yes, sir,
and what you just heard. First, second, and third verse on this, let's all sing. Almost persuaded. Here we go.
Almost persuaded now to believe. Almost persuaded Christ to receive. Seems now some soul to say, go, Spirit, go thy way. Some more convenient day on thee I'll call. Almost persuaded, come today. Almost persuaded, turn not away. Jesus invites you here, angels are lingering near. Prayer tears rise from hearts so dear. Oh, wanderer, come.
Last verse.
Almost persuaded, harvest is past. Almost persuaded, doom comes at last. Almost cannot avail. Almost is but to fail. Sad, sad that bitter wail. Almost but lost.
So important.
Yeah.
Be fully persuaded.
Amen.
Be fully persuaded. Today's song, and I always say, it's probably the one that's closest to my heart. I feel sometimes when I heard it for the first time, I knew that it was written. I know it was written for others, but I knew it was written for me. The special today is "Were It Not for Grace."
Amen.
Tell you where I
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me know how much we appreciate him. That's a great job. We're not for grace. I love that song. I appreciate that. I'm going to teach you a sermon this morning. My sermon title is called Persuaded to Do the Right Thing. Look at your bulletin one more time. I forgot to read the other verse. Look at your bulletin one more time. Do you all have a bulletin? The bottom, it says 2 Corinthians 5:11. Everybody see that? Two of us do. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are made manifest unto God, I trust, made manifest in your conscience. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Everybody understand what the preacher's trying to say? We're trying to persuade people to do the right thing. You see, the king didn't get saved, but he said in his own words, he said, I was almost persuaded. Now, let me stop and say in a nutshell, he should have got saved. When you get that close and you're almost persuaded, let God, let the preacher, let them persuade you to do the right thing. How many ever need to be persuaded to do the right thing? Take your Bible, book of Acts, chapter number 26. Let me give you a start here a little bit. Acts, chapter number 26. I'm just going to stay right there. Bear with me a little bit. I'll try to go quickly this morning. I always try to go quickly. Ended up going on forever and ever, but that's all right. It's good to be in church. Let God be in church. We came to hear from God. Let God speak to us. Acts chapter number 26. And Agrippa, verse 28. And then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. The apostle Paul referred to himself as the chief of all sinners.
Yes, sir. Amen.
The apostle Paul referred to himself as the worst of the worst of the worst. I've got them all beat. If there's an award, not that there should be, if there's an award for being a bad sinner, Paul said, I got it. I am the chief. This is a faithful saying worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners,
yes, sir.
Of whom,
yes, sir.
I am the chief. So if the preacher's the worst one in the house, there's hope for everybody else. Everybody all right with that? And so there's a pattern there. God finds the worst man he can find and makes him the preacher. Now, I just added that. So Paul referred to himself as the chief of sinners. He also referred to himself as the least of all apostles. In his own words, who said, I am not worthy to be called.
Amen.
An apostle. In his own words.
Sure.
But I think the apostle Paul was the greatest Christian to ever live. I like him. I just think he was the greatest. I admire him. I've learned from him. I don't have the intelligence level or the IQ that he had, but I think the Apostle Paul was the greatest Christian to ever live. I believe he was one who got saved. Brother Hal really got saved. He got it. He got a testimony. He knew where he was when he got saved. He knew who he was talking to. He knew the experience. He knew the importance of it, the significance. He got saved. I like people that are saved. Are you saved here this morning? Are you saved? Are you glad you're saved? Do you know you're saved? I like people who are real. I'm attracted to people that are real. I don't like people to buffalo me with all the hoopla, learn what I want to say, learn what I want to hear, tell you what you want to hear. Listen, just shoot straight. I like real people. Paul got saved. It was real to him. It was an honest thing. It was a powerful thing. It was a true salvation, a real salvation, an honest-to-goodness salvation. I mean, he got it. I mean, he got the whole kit and caboodle. It was like the Prego spaghetti sauce. Everything was in there. He got saved. Down to earth. Everything was real. Glory, hallelujah. I'm talking about saved. I'm talking about saved to the uttermost. I'm talking about saved from the work, pulled from the fiery cliff, saved, on fire for God, glad to be saved, glad to be a Christian, proud to be saved. He was the real deal, Brother Hal, the real deal. He was born again. He was saved. I like the Apostle Paul. He got saved and told everybody, what do you hear? I want to tell you, I got saved. I was a machinist. I was a long-haired biker boy from Texas. I was a machinist. I worked in Dresser Clico Pneumatic Air Tools on Pine Street, Houston, Texas. Long hair. I had a knit hat because machinery, working around the machinery, I had to be careful of my long hair getting caught in the machine. So I had a knit hat, and I would tuck all my hair up under that knit hat. And I was a machinist. I worked there in just 19 years old in the machine shop. And with a bunch of other, and I got saved. My sister invited me to church. I got saved. Almost overnight, people started noticing something's different. He said, what's happening? Well, I didn't know much Bible. I didn't know much about God. I didn't know much religious. I knew a lot about the world. I knew how to swear. I knew all the bad stuff. I knew stuff. How many knew a lot of stuff that ain't worth nothing? But Ed, I got saved. And I went to church and they kept asking, you know, what happened to you? What happened? What happened? I started to learn and I started to grow. And listen to me, I got saved. Can you imagine? I was forgiven. I'm loved. I'm a born-again Christian. You're a piece of work. I know. But you have issues. I know. But you have baggage. Amen. I know. But I got saved. Yes, sir. And what happened to you? I didn't know what to tell them. I didn't know any verses. I didn't know how to quote anything. I did not. I just told them, listen, I went to this church, Bible preaching church, preacher preaching. He was all excited, had no idea what he was talking about, but he was excited about it. He said, and my sister told me you need this. I went to the altar. He said, say this. I said this. He showed me this. I read that. He said, God loves you. God gave you a gift, the gift of eternal life. Did you want that? Of course I want. Do you want to go to hell? No, I don't want to go to hell. Do you believe in hell? I don't know, but I would if I go there, I'll believe it. He said, listen, so you need to get saved. I was 19 years old. I got saved. So I went to church. I went to work. They said, what happened? I don't know what to say to you guys. I got saved. I got saved. I'll shout it from the mountaintop. I got saved. That's all I can tell you. Well, we'll see if it lasts. It's lasted for 60 years. And I'm still saved. I like the Apostle Paul because he got the real deal. You know, I think some people that are saved didn't really get saved. Are you hearing me? You got to get something and say, do I got it or I don't have it? The Bible says he that hath it will have the witness in himself. I don't need everybody else's approval. I don't need everybody else's understanding. I don't even need my own approval. All I know is that God is faithful. I didn't want to go to hell. I got saved, and that's all I'm doing. I'm going to tell everybody else, you need to do what I did. If I said amen, you need to get saved. So the Apostle Paul, he got the real deal. Honest to goodness. I wish some Christians would put a smile on their face once in a while. I wish somebody come into the church and said, man, I'm glad to be here. Look at yourself. Can you believe we're in church? Isn't it awesome? And we're serving God, praising the Lord. I'm excited about being saved. There are three things I want to point out. This is not the sermon. I'm still on introduction. Pray for me. This is going to be a long one tonight. There are three things I want to point out about the Apostle Paul. Number one, he knew in whom he had believed. Amen. What do you mean? He knew in whom he had believed.
Yes, sir.
He did things for God. He did things in the sight of God. He did things for the will of God. He did not do these for recognition, popularity, importance, posterity. He did it for God. I believe in God. He knew in whom he had believed. And Brother Brian is my friend. I love Brother Brian. He's exciting. I think about him. I pray for him. I've worked with him. He's been faithful. He's been loyal. He's got my back. I love Brother Brian. I couldn't wait to see him. I was talking to somebody today. Remind me of Brother Brian. And I said, that's the way Brian talks. Very elegant and very sort of slow once in a while. Painful. Darn it. Have you ever talked to Brian when I grab him by the back of the neck? Spit it out, son. Spit it out. Darn. I love Brian. Couldn't wait to get back to be around. See, and I'm not in this church, Brother Brian. I'm not here for you. I love you. And I'm glad you're here. But I'm not here for you. I'm here for him. Paul said, I know whom I believe. Now, I'm glad you're here for the same reason. And that's why we have fellowship. And I like Robert. Not all the time. But I like Robert. I was glad to see him. He's my buddy. He's got my back. I love Robert. Couldn't wait to see him. Couldn't wait to be back. Make sure his health is good. We prayed for his health. I like Robert. But he's a pain in the neck. Crystal has trouble with him. She's called me sometimes, said, Pastor, I want to kill him. I said, well, what's the problem? You need help? What do you need? You need a knife? What do you want? I love Robert. That's my buddy. I was here his whole life since he was a kid. But I'm not here for you, Robert. I'm here for the Lord. You know, you'll have a better day in church when you realize I came here not because of what everybody else thinks or whatever else is saying. I'm here because of God. I came to talk about Jesus. I came. I'm here for that. And I love you. I love you. And I love, oh, my brother. I love, Brother Hal's here because we love him. What a unity we have. You know, you're starting to get to an area where you do that. Number three. Did I give you three things already? Did I do anything? Number one, he knew whom he had believed. Number two, write this down. Sir. He knew exactly what God wanted him to do. Amen. Brother Hal, he knew exactly what God wanted, what God called him to do. He knew that. And I thought about that. God, give us somebody that know what God wants, exactly what God wants, and be busy doing it. Did you know we would be a great church if everybody here knew what God wanted you to do, and you would be busy doing it? Amen. Let me see if I can say this correctly. Individually, we are to know and do what God called us to do. And collectively, we need to get together and do it. That would be a great church in a unity. He knew exactly what God wanted him to do. I was given a paper here a while back. I keep this as probably one of the greatest pieces of document I've gotten in the last 2 years. And it's ministry during a time of great change. So I read it from the men. And the pastors are affected by all that's taken place in the changes. And they're trying to decide, what do we do? This ministry changed. This church changed. What do I do? Brian, what do we do? Where do we go from here during a great time of a great change? And I thought, do I go all out with the virtual church? Which is, means electronics, online. We have Facebook displays, and I don't forget Twitter and YouTube and live stream. I'm live. That's why I have to be careful what I'm talking about. I usually like to talk about people when they're not here, but now they're watching me on television. So do we go? Now listen, we will probably always be live stream. I'm not against it. I think it's a great thing. I got people ever watching us. I actually watch our own services when I'm down south. I watch our services, watch the men preaching, watch Brother Hal's lesson, watch Brother Roger Qualls, watch Pastor Neil. And so it's just a great thing, but we'll always do that. But is that the secret? No, that's not necessarily the secret. They're trying all the different things. So they went through everything. Not only that, they said, we're going through a cataclysmic change. I said, our world has changed. Not only has change occurred, we have changes are staggering. There's changes in culture. There's changes in identity, changes in race and sexuality and politics. And the amount of change is staggering. So the pastors are trying to decide, what do we do? What do we try? Where do we go? What do we change? What do we do different? So they came up with what they call church growth strategies. I said, every pastor ought to be concerned about church. I want our church to grow. Attendance patterns, attendance membership, how do we handle everything? And so they have these strategies. And so they're following all the different church growth movements and all the strategies in the book by Robertson and McGavran and Wagner and by Hybels and Towns and Warren and the church growth and the marketplace and the church growth strategies. And they've come to the decision after doing all of these that the people still remained for about a 2-year project, and then everything went back, and they drove away, and they went away in droves. It didn't work. We don't need a new plan, don't need a new strategy, don't need a new way. So I settled it down on the conclusion with three things. There are three essential forms of ministry, and here they are. The church is renewed by preaching, teaching,
yes, sir,
and pastoral care.
Amen.
I wrote them down. I put a star by that. I said, boy, forget everything else. Drop all the programs, all the gimmicks, all the new. Listen, let's just go to church. Amen. Let's preach the word, teach the word, and care about people. Visit them, pray for them, show them how to be saved, work with them, counsel them, love them. And that, let's just be good old-fashioned church. So I wrote down number two, whoever I'm talking about here, knew. He knew exactly what God wanted him to do. Now, Brother David, I don't have all the great IQ levels of all the others. But let me tell you what I know. I know exactly what God wants me to do. And my job is to preach the word, teach the word, and care about these people.
Amen.
Pastor and caring doodle and follow those things out. Follow the will of God. And so the Bible says you do exactly what God wants him to do. And I intend to keep on doing what God called me to do. Persuading. Look at me. My job every week is to try to persuade people to do the right thing. I'll do it a little clearer for you, Joshua. My job is to persuade people to do what God wants you to do. How many ever need a little bit of help along?
Yes, sir.
I just need a little, every once in a while, a little. Well, I could be a little bit rude with you. My mom said you need a kick in the pants, but I didn't want to say it that way. Yeah? My job is to persuade people to do the right thing. That's all. Each week, one of these services, you'll come here and said, you know, I've been wrestling with this and wrestling. It's time I make a decision. It's time, look at me, it's time I do what God wants me to do. My job is to persuade people. Is that good? All right. With that said, that should be the whole sermon. I'm still on introduction, so stay with me for just a few minutes. I want to focus. Oh, did I give you three things? Oh, darn it. I'm going to give you, just wait. I can find all my paperwork here. I got stuff everywhere. Good news is I'm sorting down through the pile, so I'm getting there. Hang tight. Did anybody bring lunch? I'm hungry for a corned beef sandwich. Anybody got a corned beef sandwich on you? Where am I? Oh, number three. Oh, two, number two. Number one. He knew in whom he believed.
Yes, sir.
You better someday stop and say, God, I'm here for you. Well, so-and-so don't like me. I'm not here for so-and-so. I'm here for God.
Amen.
Well, so-and-so didn't appreciate me. So-and-so didn't say hi to me. Oh, fooey on you. Well, stop it. He knew who he believed. Number two, he knew exactly what God wanted him to do.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Number three, he worked harder at it than anybody else.
All right.
Are you okay? Paul said, I labored more. He said, I wasn't up to par with the rest of them. I wasn't comparable to the rest of them. I was nowhere near what they are. He said, but I did one thing. I worked harder than all the rest of them. So I wrote those three things down. That's just introduction. I'll get to the sermon. It's the second page, but I just, at least I got the introduction. Acts chapter 26 is about a man, is King Agrippa. Did you have your Bible open, Acts 26? I'll get to it in a minute. Stay with it. Acts chapter 26. We're going to have this meeting with King Agrippa, and I want us to watch the man of God in action. He starts in Acts chapter 26, verse 1, and Agrippa comes there, and Paul begins to speak to him and stretch forth his hand to answer for himself, so he's going to talk to him. But Paul's going to do something that I think is amazing here, and he's going to lay the whole thing out. First of all, he's going to tell you my past. Acts chapter 26, verse 9. I verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary.
Yes, sir.
To the name of Jesus. Is that what he said?
Yes.
What are you saying this for, Paul? He said, let me tell you where I come from. I didn't float down here some angel on a silver cloud with a golden spoon in my mouth. I'm a bad man. Crawled out from some wrong. I did bad things. I was not the friend. I'm the enemy of Christ. I thought within myself I ought to do many things. My past is bad. My past is sketchy. My past is violent. I messed up. Chapter 26 and verse number 13, but something happened. At midday, Acts 26 verse 13, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth. I'm in verse 14. Somebody following the story? Paul said, listen to me. Is anybody listening to me? I'm trying to tell you something happened to me. He said, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in Hebrew, them, Saul, Saul, why? Why are you that way? Why persecutest thou me? It's hard for thee to kick against the prick. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I'm in verse 15. I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. And he said this. He said, rise, stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee. Now underline these next words. I have appeared unto thee for this purpose. Paul, are you taking notes? He said, I'm going to tell you why this is all happening. For this purpose. Look at me. How many actually believe God in heaven has a purpose for your life?
Amen.
There is something you can do.
Yes, sir.
That only you can do. How many think, wow, this is awesome? I know we all kind of want to just fade into the crowd, get lost in the shuffle. But how about if the wind blew the shaft and everything away and there you stand out in the field all by yourself? What does God want you to do? Now, you know what you and I do? We start looking around at everybody else and say, well, what are they doing? What are they doing? And what about them? How many got kids? I told you to go downstairs, get the laundry, put it in the basket, bring it up here, fold the towels, put them in the bathroom, put them in the closet. Now, what are they going to do? Don't worry about what they're going to do. You do what I told you to do. Wash the dishes. Take out the trash. Man, I didn't use all these dishes.
Amen.
So we're going to play this kind of a game now? So we're just going to wash the dishes you use? And take out the trash that you put in there. And then we'll wash clothes. We're only going to wash the clothes that were. Stop it. How many think, I need to figure out what God wants me to do and quit worrying what everybody else is doing? And let me take a word out of your vocabulary. Can I take a word out of your vocabulary? The word fair. No, there's not fair. Will you stop it? How many believe God's been better, good to me, better to me than I deserve? Knock this fairness. God's not fair. Oh, pfft. How many think God's been more than fair? Give me somebody who's going to go to church that God's been better to me than I deserve. God's been good to me. God's been so good to me. I don't know where I'm at on the lesson here. Oh, he said I got saved. All right, number two. Right, I'm in verse, did I get to verse 16? All right, I want you to take notes for your life now. Did I get to, where was the purpose at? Where am I? Yeah, I'm in the right place. 16. I got my finger right on it. I got my finger on it, still can't read it. Stay out of my preaching. I never liked you. Let me give you a list of other churches in the area. No, I'm just playing, but I love you. Brother Brian, we're taking note. Unto thee, for this purpose. Boy, Brother Hal, it'd be a good day when everybody realized their importance. Amen. And their purpose in God's plan. God pity you who aren't where you're supposed to be. Amen. When God wanted to use you. Did you hear what I just said?
Yes,
sir. Someone told it to me this way. Pastor, I learned a long time ago, the greatest ability is availability. So the Bible says, for this purpose. Now I'm taking notes. Now verse 16.
Yes, sir.
To make thee a what, Hal? Minister.
Amen.
Verse 16. He said, God, Jesus said, Paul, yes, I'm going to make you a minister. Amen. Now if I was Paul, I said, are you kidding me? Who is this really? Me? I persecuted the church. I've got a bad record. I said, they'll never. I said, I've got to join the other side. Listen, this isn't going to work. We got a wrong number. Try again. This is the other Paul. He said, I'm going to make you a minister. And notice that I'm looking at verse 16, a minister, this is your purpose. You're going to be a minister and a witness. Both of these things without I seen, and those things which I will appear unto thee. Delivering thee, I'm in verse 17. Follow me now. I got to get through the lesson here. Where am I at? Oh my gosh. Delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee. You're going to sin. Listen to me. I'm going to tell you your purpose. I'm going to make a minister of you, a witness of you, to testify of these things, and I'm going to send you to people.
Amen.
What are you going to send me there for? Look at me. I'm going to send you to people that by God's grace and by God's power and by your diligence, you're going to be able to persuade them to get what you got. How many think that's what a witness is? I want you to have what I have. I want you to know that God loves you too. I want you to know you can be saved. I want you to know you can be forgiven. I want you to know you can have a home in heaven. I want you to know you can have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I want you to know that Christ died for you, just like for me, for everybody. Isn't that awesome to know? I want you to know the gospel. I want you to know good news. I want you to know that God did not come here to condemn you.
No, sir.
He said, I send not my son. I came not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen.
I came to save you. And you're going to go around telling people that. That's your purpose. Persuading people to do the right thing. Follow me now. I'm not done. He said, I'm going to send you to the Gentiles in verse 17. Everybody got that? I'm going to send you some people. I'm going to send you. Verse number 18. Now, here's what you're going to do. When you get there, he said, the reason I sent you is that you might, verse 18, to open. Is that what it says? Now, I'm not making fun of anybody. I'm not criticizing anybody. But how many have ever walked around and feel like I have no clue what I'm doing? How many ever feel like I'm in the dark? I'm confused. You know, Pastor, are your eyes shut? Well, I don't know if you want to say it that way or not. I'm just telling you, God says I need to open their eyes. God, help me see. What are we doing? What am I living for? Where are we going? Why am I here? Where did I come from? Open my eyes. Help me. I got trouble. He said, I want you to open their eyes. Turn them. I'm in verse 18. Turn them from darkness. To the light.
Amen.
From the power of, help me, from the power of unto God.
Yes, sir.
He said, that you're gonna, that's, you want me to do that? By the way, come on, every born again Christian, follow me and I will make you fishers of men.
Yes, sir.
Does all this incorporate that as well? How many think that's the purpose for my life? Bringing others, turning others, opening the eyes of others, persuading, am I right?
Amen.
That they may receive, look at that, that they may receive,
forgiveness, yes, sir.
What a God.
Amen.
What a God that loves us. He said, I love people. He said, Pastor, do you believe everybody can go to heaven? I absolutely do. Do you believe everybody will go to heaven? No, I don't. Well, what's the difference? It's all one thing. Some allowed themselves to be persuaded to do the right thing. King, almost thou persuaded. Oh, come on, King, you're this close. Almost persuaded. He said, to receive forgiveness and inheritance among them which are sanctified. Verse number 19. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was, help me with it, not. Can somebody tell me what does that mean? For once in my life, I'm going to do exactly what God told me to do. How many Christians here have ever been disobedient? How many have ever failed? How many have been neglectful? How many has ever been a dum-dum? A schmuck? But for the grace of God, you should have been squished like a bug. I always did. No, I don't. Only Christ always did those things that pleased him. But I did a lot of things I shouldn't have done. How many done things you knew you shouldn't have done? How many of you done things you hope nobody ever finds out? How many of you glad God forgives us for them all? He said, I was not disobedient. Pastor, what are you doing up here? What are you so wound up about all the time? I'm trying to persuade people to not be disobedient. Brother Hal, that's all we want them to do, what God wants you to do. Paul said, I knew what he wanted me to do. I knew where he wanted to send me. I knew what he wanted me to say. I knew I was supposed to open their eyes. I knew I was supposed to tell my story. I know I'm supposed to be a witness. I know I'm supposed to be a minister. Do I get a vote? Nope, no vote for you. Just sign on the bottom line. How many with me? I surrender all. I was 19 years old. I knew God was calling me. I knew something was happening. I was growing in that first year. Somewhere toward the end of that year, I'd kneel at the altar praying. And I just knew. And he said, Larry, he said, what do you think is going on? I said, I don't know. I just know he wants me to do something. I just don't know. He said, have you come to surrender? I said, yes, I surrender my life. What will God do with you? I don't know. But how many of you think God is good? Whatever he wants to do, where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, I will follow. That's a surrender life. Paul said, Brother Hal, there are a lot of people that have not done and will not do what God told him to do. But Paul said, write my name down. I was not disobedient. I was stubborn.
Yes, sir.
I had a long way to go. I had a lot of work to be done. But I was persuaded, and I was not disobedient to do what God told me to do. Follow me now. I'm trying to finish up the lesson here. Wherefore, I was not disobedient. I'm in verse 19. Now look at verse 20. Follow this now. Watch this, Robert. Verse 20. I was not disobedient, but showed first unto them of... God bless the people of Damascus. We got somebody that did what God told him to do. God's got something for you. God loves you. God bless the man that went to Damascus. And at Jerusalem. Well, God bless you folks at Jerusalem. The Apostle Paul is here. The eastern tornado has blown in. The whirlwind from God. The minister, a man with a purpose, a man with a call, a man with a fervor, a man with salvation, a man with a testimony. Jerusalem, God. And, I'm in verse 20, are you following me? And throughout all the coasts of Judea. Pastor, I don't know where all these places are. Don't matter. There are people there. And the preacher went and told them.
Yes, sir.
And then to the Gentiles.
Amen.
How's it working? That they should repent and turn to God. All right, look at me. One word. Look at me. One word. Golden star for whoever answers my question. One word. You said he went to Damascus? Jerusalem? All the coasts, the Gentiles. What did he go there for? Nope. One word. One word. Who said that? To persuade them to repent and, help me, turn. Do you guys get that? Did you get the sermon this morning?
Yes, sir.
The whole sermon is this. Persuading people to do the right thing. So how'd it go? Verse 21. It didn't go good.
No.
Didn't go good? No, he got in trouble for doing what God told him to do. So how about then let's just find us a little pity party somewhere, find a corner, sit and cry. It ain't working. Oh, stop. For this cause, the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to...
Yes, sir.
Isn't that awesome? We finally have a man who's doing what God told him to do. And the people want to kill him.
Yep.
Welcome to my world. That's why you ought to come to church every week. Listen, I don't care who you are. You need to be here because by faith, by God's grace, you're learning, you're trying to grow, you're trying to get a hold. But I'm warning you, this world will kill you.
Yes, sir.
Stay. He said, having therefore obtained help. I'm in verse 22.
Yes, sir.
Having, isn't this awesome, Brother Hal? Having therefore obtained help of God, I like this. I went in my grave, write these two words. I continued. He kept on keeping on. You couldn't stop him. He was like the ever ready bunny. Knocked him down. He got up, kept going on and on, banging the drum. I continue. I wish some Christians wouldn't stop. Witnessing. Let's notice this now. Witnessing. Both to,
yes,
what does that mean? I'm trying to go everywhere I can and persuade people to do the right thing. I like Abraham, he staggered not the promises of God. I like the Apostle Paul, he works harder at it than anybody else. I'm trying to persuade people to do the right thing. Let me give you some thoughts here real quick. I think we need to persuade people to do the right thing. We need to persuade people to get saved. It is an offer that won't always be available. Jesus is coming back, listen to me, and I warn you, in Matthew 24, the Bible clearly says, some,
yes, sir,
will be left behind.
Amen.
We need to persuade people to do the right thing. It is a safe and sure offer. You can trust God. Be persuaded. The one person who won't fail you is God. One person who won't lie to you is God. If he says he'll save you, he'll save you. Number three, the only reason why people reject this offer is three reasons. Number one, they don't know about it. Welcome to Heritage Baptist Church. I'm here to tell you God loves you. And God will save you. The woman at the well, he said to the woman at the well, if thou knewest the gift of God. Why did you say that? If thou knewest the gift of God. You mean she doesn't know about it? She didn't even know? The reason people aren't saved is some of them don't know. Well, welcome to church. It is my job and your job to tell them God will save them. We better get busy. We're running out of time. The second reason I want you to notice is those who know but were deceived or rejected the offer. Those who do know but were deceived. Oh, you don't need to do that. You don't, they're just religious. Those guys, they bump their head. You know, they too many jalapeno peppers. They don't know what they're talking about. Or number three. The only reason I think somebody rejected this offer, number three, somebody is holding on to something that they don't want to let go of. Can sin keep me from getting saved?
Amen.
Can you look at me this morning? I'm done. I'm going to stop. I'm done. My job is to persuade you. To let go of whatever's keeping you from doing what God wants. I'm trying my hardest to persuade you. You got sin in your life, welcome to the club. How many have had lots of changes? But by the grace of God, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. How many think God wants to make some changes in my life? I'm trying to persuade you to do the right thing. I'm trying to persuade you to do the right thing. Let's all stand. I wish that king would have got saved. He said, I was almost persuaded. Almost persuaded to do the right thing. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Let me pray. Father, we need you as much as we've ever needed you. You did not come to condemn us. You're not the problem or the cause of the problem. You're the solution. There are people here, for sure, they know. And they also, as the king was, almost persuaded to join, persuaded to get saved, persuaded to change, persuaded, almost persuaded. Help us, Father, be persuaded to do the right thing. I like the fact that the Apostle Paul said, I was not disobedient. Lord God, I have to kneel at this altar. I cannot say the same words. I was disobedient. I was stubborn. I was in denial. I was rejecting. Help me be persuaded to do the right thing. In Jesus' name, amen. You come, the altar is open. You come on the first verse, Brother Brian.
Just as
you come, take a minute. You come this morning. This is your time. Almost persuaded. Got to make some decisions. Got to make some changes. Got to make a move. I got to do the right thing. I got to do the right thing. Persuaded.
And as thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. Just as to rid my soul of one dark lot, to thee whose blood can cleanse its spot, O Lamb.
while the ushers are coming, getting ready to take the offering, let me just make a quick statement to you. I need a little bit of help in getting saved. You may need a little help. Ask me. Ask me. I'll help you. Show the verses with you. Help you. Show you how to pray, what to pray for. I'll help you to bring peace. But don't let this go. Ask the question, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be born again? And I'll be glad to help you. I'm glad somebody helped me.
Yes, sir.
How many are glad I got saved?
Amen.
I'm glad I got saved. Praise the Lord. Almost persuaded. Let's bow. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the church and the offering. God bless our church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes.
You may be seated. I'm all done. I want to thank everybody who's involved in the ministry. Do me a favor. Thank the people. These guys in the sound booth help us. Brother Brian helps us. Brother Paul does the cleaning here. Did a great job. It smelled like pine salt the other day. It smelled so great in here in the cleaning. But thanks all you people for your faithfulness today. Pray for our church. Pray for visitors. And pray for the next generation. I'm done. Let's all stand and pray. Thank you, thank you. Let's stand and pray. Bring somebody to church with you. Bring somebody to church. We're here because somebody brought us. Bring somebody to church with you. Talk about it. Be a witness. Be a testimony. Persuade them. Come with me. Our Father in heaven, thank you for church. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for this fellowship. Be with our dear people, Lord. Keep them safe. Keep them healthy. Bless their families, their jobs, their homes. Keep them warm. Keep them safe. Thank you, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you. You are just...